Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Saving Grace by Lee Smith, narrated by Christina Moore. This work is copyrighted 1995 by Lee Smith. This recording is copyrighted 2000 by Recorded Books. Lee Smith opens this novel with a verse from Little Gidding, from the Four Quartets of T.S. Eliot. We shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time. And now, Saving Grace.
Scrabble Creek. My name is Florida Grace Shepherd. Florida for the state I was born in. Grace for the grace of God. I am the 11th child of the Reverend Virgil Shepherd, born to him and his third wife, Fanny Flowers. They say I take after her, and I am proud of this, for she was lovely as the day is long, in spirit as well as flesh. It isn't true, however. I am, and always have been, contentious and ornery, full of fear and doubt, in a family of believers. Mama used to call me her worrywart child. You've got to trust more in Jesus, Gracie, she'd tell me again and again in her pretty voice, which always reminded me of running water, of Scrabble Creek falling down the mountain beside our house. You've got to give over to him, she'd say. Hasn't he always took good care of us? The Lord will provide, she'd say, smoothing my long yellow hair and pressing me against her bosom, where I could smell the familiar smell of cotton dried out on a line. She'd hold me until I quit crying, maybe sing me a little song. Mama was never in a hurry when we were kids. She had all the time in the world for us, putting down whatever she was doing in order to catch us up and comfort us. Mama took good care of us, as good as she could. This was not true of Daddy, nor of Jesus either, as far as I could see. Daddy and Mama talked about Jesus all the time. I loved Daddy and Mama, but I did not love Jesus. And I actually hated him when he made us take up traveling in his name, living with strangers and in tents and old school buses and what have you. I couldn't understand why we had to do this, why this was required of us alone when other children I knew from school got to live in a nice brick house and have Barbie dolls and radios. I was full of resentment and raged against him in my heart, but I knew better than to say it out loud, for then they might decide I was possessed by the devil and try to cast him out as directed by Acts chapter 10, verse 38. I had seen this done and did not want it done to me. But I worried and worried about everything. I worried that the devil might really be in me after all, growing like a baby inside of me until I got so big that everyone could see and everyone would know my awful secret. When I think on my childhood now, it appears to me as a wild mountainside where I was lost. Often over the years, I have dreamed about it. In these dreams, I always have a duty to take something to somebody, to tell somebody something. But the trees are thick, and the path disappears beneath my feet. I never know where I'm going, and I never get there. I reckon I never did get there. This is why I have had to come back now, traveling these dusty old back roads one more time. For I mean to tell my story, and I mean to tell the truth. I am a believer in the Word, and I am not going to flinch from telling it, not even the terrible things, not even the part about Lamar, nor how Mama died, nor the true nature of Travis Word, nor what transpired between me and Randy Newhouse. I have entered these dark woods yet again, for I've got to find out who I am and what has happened to me, so that I can understand what is happening to me now and what is going to happen to me next. My best memories come from Scrabble Creek. This is where we lived the longest, in the house God gave us when I was 7 years old. We had come to North Carolina from Georgia in an old car that blew up in the mountains near Waynesville in the summer of 1949. The car was a blue, humpbacked Studebaker. A used car dealer in Stone Mountain, Georgia, had given it to Daddy free for healing his baby daughter of croup. It made a funny noise, but it ran pretty good until that August afternoon when it just flat exploded on a high, narrow mountain road, with Daddy driving, of course, and Evelyn and Billie Jean and Joe Allen and me crammed in the back seat and Mama nursing Troy Lee in the front. All of a sudden, there came a big pow noise, and the car lunged over to the left, away from the edge of the mountain, thank the Lord, and came to rest at an angle against a rocky cliff. Black smoke poured out from under the hood. We scrambled all over each other trying to get out, which was hard, since the left side of the car was pushed against the mountain and the right side was up in the air. One by one, we jumped. "We're wrecked! We're wrecked!" Joe Allen shouted, running around and around. "Joe Allen, stop that foolishness this minute," Mama directed from inside the car. "Evelyn, come over here and get Troy Lee," she said, and handed him out to my older sister. Troy Lee was crying like crazy, his face bright red. Mama jumped out lightly after him, like she was entirely accustomed to jumping out of burning cars, and took Troy Lee back from Evelyn and comforted him. "Now, now," she said. "There now." I clung to Mama's skirt and wished that Troy Lee had never been born, or that he would die, so that Mama would hug me. My handsome daddy followed Mama out, yelling, "Praise be to Jesus," as he hit the ground. For traveling, Daddy always took off his jacket and drove in a white shirt with the sleeves rolled up. Daddy was 56 then, but he seemed younger because he was so full of energy. The Holy Spirit kept him hopping, as he said. His eyes were a sharp, bright blue. His long, curly hair had been turned pure white by God in a vision on top of Roan Mountain in Tennessee when he was 25 years old. "All right, children," he said calmly. "Help me now." And we untied the bundles that were lashed to the top and the back of the Studebaker and got them over to the far side of the road just before the car exploded in earnest, its hood popping off, a great plume of smoke shooting straight up in the air. "My goodness," Mama said. Billie Jean was sucking her thumb, and Evelyn was crying.
"What will we do?" Evelyn sobbed wildly. "What will we ever do now?"
Daddy fell to his knees in the road and started praying. I knew he would take the explosion as a sign. Daddy was ever on the lookout for signs and wonders, which were vouchsafed to him accordingly.
"I guess we'll just take to the tent again," Joe Allen said darkly, kicking at our biggest bundle, the green canvas gospel tent which we had slept in before, and plenty of times at that. I wished with all my heart that it was burning up in the Studebaker. I hated it when we stayed in the gospel tent. One time we had slept out in that tent in the blowing snow. Another time, in summer, I woke up one morning and found both my eyes swollen shut from bug bites. That was in Dahlonega, Georgia. Now Mama sat down on the rolled-up tent and unbuttoned her blouse and set into feeding Troy Lee some more. A piece of her long blonde hair had come loose from its bun, and it fell in a screen across her face as she leaned over Troy Lee. The rest of us pulled back from the heat of the blazing car, but continued to watch it closely as it shimmered and snapped, except for Daddy, who stayed right where he was.
"I'm hungry," Billie Jean said, but nobody answered her.
We were all hungry.
We had slept in the car the night before, piled on top of each other, and breakfast had been half a loaf of white bread, hours and hours before. I'd never cry, though. I'd die first. I took pride in not being a whiner like Billie Jean. I ignored my empty stomach and looked up the dark column of smoke past the tops of the dusty green trees to a patch of deep blue sky. I wished I could just float away with the smoke, away from there, away from them all. "I'm hungry," Billie Jean said again, and again nobody answered her. We knew there was nothing to eat. Mama buttoned herself back up and placed Troy Lee face down across her lap. Butterflies fluttered around her. She smiled at us.
"I'll swear," she said, "if it's not the prettiest day."
About 5 minutes later, a gray truck came rumbling along the road and stopped. God had answered Daddy's prayer. The back of the truck held 3 boxes with hunting dogs in them, and all the dogs started barking at once. A man got out as quick as he was able. He had a long red face and a nose with a knob on it. "You folks okay?" he hollered over the sound of the fire and the barking and Billie Jean's crying and Daddy's praying.
"Why, yes, praise Jesus, we are," Mama said sweetly.
The man walked over to get a closer look at Daddy.
"Son of a gun," he said.
He stood there in the middle of the road and waited until Daddy finished praying and got up.
"Virgil Shepherd, minister of God," Daddy said, grinning his big grin and holding his hand out. "Mighty pleased to meet you."
"Likewise."
The man said his name was Carlton Duty, and he was going on to say something else when the other door of the truck swung open and a woman stuck her curly red head out.
"And this here is my wife, Ruth," he said.
We would learn that Ruth Duty loved children and hadn't ever been able to have any. She had the kindest heart in the world.
"Why, this is awful," she cried. "You poor little things. You all look like something the cat drug up. I tell you what, I've got a coconut cake in here that we was taking over to my sister's." She pointed at me. "Honey, you come on over here and help me."
So I ran right up to the Duty's truck, and Mrs. Duty handed me a platter holding a great big cake covered all over with little white strings of coconut, which we had never seen before. I took the cake and put it down in the road beside Mama, and then Daddy came over and sat on a rock and cut it up with his pocket knife. Though we were about to faint with hunger by then, we knew better than to start eating before Daddy had said the blessing. He stretched out his arms and set in.
"Hallelujah! Oh, he's a good God that has led us up here from Georgia and give us his sign of holy fire and provided us a feast in the middle of the day. He's a good God, hallelujah!"
Daddy went on and on the way he always did, but I peeped out from under my eyelids to watch Carlton Duty just standing there, leaned up against his truck, staring at Daddy with his mouth open. Daddy had had this effect on people before. I thought I would die of starvation before he finally hollered, "Amen!" and picked up a piece of cake. In my whole life, I have never tasted anything to equal Mrs. Ruth Duty's coconut cake. Even today, it makes my mouth water just to think about it. I reckon we ate like we were about starved, which we were. The Duties came near to watch us eat, Carlton Duty smoking a cigarette, and Mrs. Ruth Duty hovering around our little circle like a big old moth. We didn't even have anything to wash the cake down with. We just ate. I thought we had died and gone to heaven for sure. We ate until every crumb of that cake was gone, and then we stretched out our legs and lay back against the mossy bank and blessed God and watched our car finish burning up. And Daddy told Carlton Duty how we had got there. "Mr. Duty," he said, "I preach the gospel of Jesus Christ as it is written in his holy Bible, amen, and not in no other place. And I am out here on the road following his divine plan where he said, 'Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature.' My religion is not a mouth religion, Mr. Duty, no sir. I am following the plan of God. I will do what he tells me to do. I will go where he tells me to go and stop where he tells me to stop. Praise his sweet name."
"But what about all these poor sweet little young'uns?" cried Mrs. Duty, looking at us.
"I cannot think of no better plan for them than to follow the plan of God," Daddy said. "These children may not have new clothes on their back nor new shoes on their feet, but they are going to heaven with me. These children are on the road to salvation. Isn't that right, Fanny?"
Daddy asked Mama, not taking his eyes off Carlton Duty's face, not even nodding when Mama smiled and said,
"That's right."
I snuggled over closer to Mama and the sleeping Troy Lee, while Evelyn held Billie Jean in her lap and Joe Allen poked around in the woods with a stick. Carlton Duty swallowed hard.
"Do you mean to tell me, sir," he said, "that you'uns wasn't even for sure where you was a-going? That you did not have no more definite destination in mind than heaven?"
"That's right, brother," Daddy said seriously. "As it says in the good Bible, this world is not our home. We're only passing through.
We're following the plan of God, brother, and we have given our lives over to him.
He is leading us where he wants us to go, and today he has brung us to...
Here Daddy paused and narrowed his eyes and asked, "What place is this?"
"Well, you're about 9 miles outside of Waynesville," Carlton Duty said.
"Bless Jesus," Daddy said, reaching his arms up in the air and bowing his white head to the will of God. His left hand was still blue-black and swollen from where he had gotten bit in Clayton.
"Bless Jesus," Daddy continued, "who has showed us by the sign of fire in his holy woods, 9 miles outside of Waynesville, North Carolina, his plan for our life today, by freeing us from the things of this world and casting us wholly on his mercy, amen, and by bringing us his blessing as a gift of food from his good servants Carlton and Ruth Duty, amen."
"Shoot, it's just a cake," Ruth Duty said in the silence that followed Daddy's prayer. But Daddy appeared beatified, gazing around at the smoking skeleton of the car and the thick green woods and the blooming black-eyed Susans beside the road, as if he had never seen such sights in his whole life. Bumblebees droned and yellow butterflies fluttered around us. Carlton Duty cleared his throat. He looked at his wife.
"Well," he said, "seeing as how things are, I believe I might be able to help you out. You and stay right here, and I'll be back directly."
"God be with you," Daddy told him.
They climbed back in the truck and rattled off down the road with the dogs barking all at once. Mrs. Ruth Duty waved out the window. We sat there and watched them go until there was nothing left of them at all except a puff of dust that hung in the hot, still air above the rutted road. Then Joe Allen came crashing through the underbrush and reported that he had found a spring, and Evelyn and Billie Jean and I started off down the steep hill after him. Down, down, down we went until we came to a deep, shady spot where the spring bubbled up between the mossy rocks like a fountain. We cupped our hands and drank like we were dying of thirst, like it was our last chance for water in the world. The spring water was cool and sweet, delicious. Finally, I quit drinking and raised my dripping chin and looked back up the mountain. And there stood Daddy, black against the sun. His white shirt and his white hair appeared to be shooting off rays of light behind his dark form. I did not wave or holler at him. I started playing with Joe Allen and Evelyn and Billie Jean. We built a dam and made a little lake and sailed leaf boats in it. The whole time we played, I knew that Daddy was watching over us. 3 the medium of Carlton Duty, God provided us with a completely furnished 4-room house on Scrabble Creek, the nicest place we ever lived. This house was actually owned by a woman named Elvie Mayhew, who had left it for good the minute her husband, Lester Mayhew, died one night while they were having supper a year before our arrival. They had been eating green beans and mashed potatoes, now dried forever to the plates still on the table. Mama had to throw these plates out, and also the pots on the stove. Daddy cut back the trumpet vine that had grown in through the open kitchen window and swept out the chicken droppings on the floors. The chickens themselves were long gone, probably eaten up by animals, Daddy said. The well was choked by ivy. We boiled the linens in a big iron pot on a wood fire outside the house and beat out the corn shuck mattresses in the sun. Carlton Duty brought a scythe to cut the waist-high weeds in the yard and clear a path to the toilet. Mama was so worried that Elvie Mayhew might come back, but everybody said she had lost her mind and been sent to live with her sister in Ohio. Finally, Mama just quit worrying and delighted in the house, which had everything. An oilcloth-covered table and 4 chairs in the kitchen, a tufted horsehair sofa and a rocking chair, and a faded velvet easy chair in the sitting room, plus a heat stove, 1 bedroom for Mama and Daddy and Troy Lee, then a great big bedroom for us kids. The sitting room, kitchen, and Mama and Daddy's bedroom were built in a row, and then our bedroom went out at the side so that the house was shaped like an upside-down L. A porch ran around the inside of the L. Most every night we'd sit out there till it got pure dark, reading the Bible out loud to Daddy, one after the other.
Of course, he wouldn't let us read anything except the Bible. He said that was all we needed to read. We were not even allowed to read the newspaper, as the only news we needed to know was the good news of the gospel, and anything else would distract us from it. One time, Daddy caught Evelyn with a love magazine and beat her with his belt until her back was covered with welts. Daddy believed in spare the rod and spoil the child, and practiced this for our own good. Anyway, we had climbing red roses on the porch rail and two pictures hanging up on the walls, one of a vase full of flowers in the sitting room, and the other of an Indian brave in a canoe paddling through a swamp on the wall in our bedroom. I thought Daddy would make us take these down, but he didn't. He said something about it when we first moved in, but then he appeared to forget them. Daddy was so busy following the plan of God that he didn't pay us much mind in general as we settled into the only real house we would ever have. That house which always comes into my mind, along with the happy sound of Scrabble Creek. The mountain was steep beside our house, and the creek proceeded down it in a line of little waterfalls all the way to the road. Each waterfall had its own pool, some of them big enough to fish in, or to swim in when it got real hot. We couldn't really swim, of course, at least us girls couldn't. We were not allowed to learn how, and we had to keep our skirts and blouses on even when we waded. Holiness girls have to stay covered up. Still, it was exciting. A great thrill would shoot through me whenever I held my nose and dunked myself all the way down under the cold, rushing stream, even though Mama had said not to. But she didn't really seem to mind when Daddy was gone and it was sunny so our clothes could dry out. Mama was that way about a lot of things when Daddy was gone off preaching. We got to play more and even dress up sometimes in the clothes we had found in the Mayhew's attic. For me and Evelyn and Billie Jean, who had always lived in a single dress apiece and passed those down from one to another, this attic was a treasure trove. There was even an old yellow wedding dress, which Evelyn soon found and put on. This was when I first realized that Evelyn was beautiful. Though she was only 11 at the time, she held herself erect in that dress and walked in a way I'd never seen her walk before. I helped her pick a bouquet of blue flowers that grew by the creek, wild phlox, I think it was. And then we called Mama to come and watch Evelyn hold her bouquet in front of her and walk down the length of the porch. To our surprise, Mama covered her face with her hands and started crying as if her heart would break. We ran over to her, me and Evelyn and Billie Jean, but she would not be comforted. "Oh, me," she sobbed. "I just want you girls to be happy." Then she sat down on the porch step and cried and cried and cried. "Take it off," Mama finally said to Evelyn, and Evelyn, scared to death, did so that very minute, to stand thin and white in her shift on the sagging porch, our old Evelyn again. "Don't you never let me see you in such as that," Mama said. "You know what your daddy would think. I've got a good mind to tear that dress up for under things," she said, looking at it where it lay in a fancy yellow heap. But she did not. The dress went back into its box and back up in the attic, and none of us ever mentioned its existence to Daddy. From that magic attic, we all got real coats for the winter, a plain green one for Evelyn, a blue one with a white collar for Mama, a hunting jacket for Joe Allen, a ripped black greatcoat that Mama made into coats for Troy Lee and Billie Jean, and a navy pea jacket that went to me. I dearly loved my pea jacket, which had anchors on the buttons. Also, it looked like a boy's jacket, and I wanted to be a boy then, like Joe Allen, and go off to play ball or hunt with the other boys and cut my hair short like the girls in town and not have to stay home all the time and help Mama. If I could just be a boy, I wouldn't even mind going to work at the sawmill like Joe Allen did as soon as he was old enough, at 13. Daddy himself did not work a regular job. He was too busy. He had to travel a lot, like the Apostle Paul. Mama explained it all to us. "Your daddy is a saint," she said, "a precious saint of God." And in spite of the frequent sadness in her pale gray eyes and the shadow that sometimes fell on her face, we never doubted for a minute that she loved him. Maybe she loved him even more since she knew she could lose him at any time because of what he had to do.
Whenever Daddy walked in the door, everything suddenly got real exciting. All the familiar sights and objects of our lives, the bright flapping quilts on the line, the silvery falling-in barn halfway down the hill, the green forest around our house, took on a deeper, richer hue. Nobody could laugh louder or pray longer or swing you up higher in the air than our Daddy. And when he looked at Mama, something passed between the two of them which I didn't understand, something which scared me and made me lie restless in my bed, straining to hear them in the other room. Often I heard Daddy's voice talking and talking deep into the night, mixed with Mama's softer tone. But I could never make out the words. Sometimes Mama would call out in a way I could not account for. On those nights, I'd lie awake for hours while Billie Jean slept in the bed beside me. Sometimes I'd hear the serpents rattling in their boxes under our beds, but I was used to the sound, and finally it would put me to sleep. The fact is, I felt safe in that house on Scrabble Creek, the safest I ever felt in childhood. I was raised to believe that the things of this world are not important, and I know it is true, but a house is different. A house will give you a place on the earth. If you know where you live, you know who you are. I loved being the girl who lived in the house by the musical creek, with blue willow dishes in the corner cupboard, and a little army of gladiolas that sprang up every summer around the white quartz rock in the yard, red glads that stood straight and proud as soldiers. They were blooming when we first moved in, and Mama had a fit about them. She loved flowers, any flowers. After we got settled, she started weeding all around the yard, with Troy Lee beside her on a quilt. "Looky here," she'd say, "there's a rosebush under this honeysuckle." Or once, in a tone of rapture, "Oh, Gracie, peonies!" Though we would not get to see the peonies bloom until the next spring. Evelyn and Billie Jean and I got to stay at home to help Mama, but Jo Allen had to go with Daddy and Carlton Duty to build the brush arbor. God could not have sent a better man to Daddy's side than Carlton Duty. He lived on land that had been in his family for 100 years and ran a store down at the crossroads named Duty's Grocery, where Ruth sold her famous pound cakes and fried pies. People went out of their way to get some of Ruth Duty's cooking. The Duties were well known and liked throughout that community, but it was not generally known that Carlton had been having a hard time of late, with black days and sleepless nights, for no good reason. It was like a heaviness had come over him from the heart, and everything was turning gray before his eyes. He had stopped going to church and didn't even want to go down to the store. Ruth had been worried sick about him. She told Mama that Carlton's brother, Rule, had shot himself in the head when he was exactly Carlton's age, 35. Now she was scared that Carlton was fixing to do the same thing. She was afraid it ran in the family. Carlton's daddy had done it, too. Ruth Duty told Mama all this as she stood in our yard holding a lemon chess pie, with her big bosom heaving and her blue eyes swimming in tears. "If we could have just had us some children," Ruth said, looking at us, ranged solemnly up and down the steps, watching her sob, and wondering when she planned to hand over the pie. Mama, barefoot, held Troy Lee on her hip and smiled at Ruth Duty. "Things is fixing to change," she said. "Watch and see." For Mama had the gift of discernment. As usual, Mama was right. Carlton Duty caught religion from Daddy in a big way, and soon was Daddy's right-hand man and an elder in his new church. First they built the brush arbor. The Duty's land was too poor to farm good, but there was one piece of it right off the road down from the store that was tailor-made for the Lord, Daddy said, not to mention the Little Dove River behind it, which was great for baptizing. They had plenty of help. Once people met Daddy, they couldn't stay away. He was more alive than anybody else, with energy to spare, and in that poor place of hardscrabble farms and hand-to-mouth lives, he was the main thing happening. People were drawn to Daddy like bugs to a flame. He had something they wanted, and they'd stick around to find out what it was. The men made the roof out of poles and brush, and the floor out of wood shavings and sawdust, and finished the brush arbor up with sawmill slab benches. The whole time they were working, Daddy was preaching. I don't think he was ever not preaching. He often said that a preacher is a preacher 24 hours a day, that the Lord's work is never done. When the brush arbor was finished, they put two loudspeakers on a plank and mounted this across the top of Carlton Duty's truck. Speakers like that were against the law, but Daddy always said he obeyed God's laws, not man's, quoting from Acts chapter 5, verse 29. Then Carlton Duty drove Daddy all over that part of the county, announcing the revival meeting that would start the following Saturday night. But they drove by our house first and stopped in the road at the bottom of the hill. Evelyn and Billie Jean and I were sitting in the grass under the big tulip poplar, making daisy chain jewelry. "Fanny Shepherd," Daddy said over the loudspeaker. "Fanny Shepherd and little children," he said, "come see what the Lord has wrought." His voice filled our whole holler. Billie Jean started crying and hung back, but Evelyn and me ran down the hill along with Mama.
"What in the world?"
Mama said. Rosy-faced and breathless from running, she wore a daisy chain necklace, which we had made for her. Holiness women cannot wear real jewelry, and she had said she didn't know if she ought to put it on or not, but she'd been too surprised by the loudspeaker to take it off. Daddy was leaning out the truck window, laughing at her, and then his eyes narrowed as he looked at her good.
"Hang on a minute," he said to Carlton Duty,
and then he swung down from the truck, his white shirt sleeves rolled up and his collar open, still looking at Mama. We were scared. We didn't know what he meant to do. He pulled Mama over to him and kissed her long and hard, right there in the middle of the road, in the middle of the day.
"You're a beautiful woman, Fanny," he said when he let her go.
Then he got back in the truck, and Carlton Duty drove him away, and me and Evelyn waved goodbye until they were out of sight. Mama stood there giggling like a girl. Even today, I don't know how to describe Daddy's voice, for that was surely one of his greatest blessings from the Lord. To start off with, he did not sound like a preacher. He did not fall into the sing-song chant you hear so often. No, Daddy had a deep, ringing voice and spoke real slow so that every word he said registered and seemed to settle directly on the soul. He talked to God like he was sitting right across from him, like they were old friends. He talked to everybody that same way. In fact, not like most preachers who will yell at you and shame you and try to make you feel bad. Daddy's voice made you feel good, like you were strong in the Lord and proud to do his will. "I declare," Ruth Duty said one time to Mama, "that man ought to have been a salesman. Why, he could sell anything to anybody. He could have made a fortune." Of course, I wish Daddy would have turned his talents more in this direction, so we could have had decent school clothes at least. But he said that he could not afford to waste his time studying on the things of earth. Jesus wouldn't let him. Daddy did not even take up money at meetings unless it was a special offering for somebody whose house had burned down or their child was sick or something like that. He would not take up money for us, so we never had any. And I don't know what we would have done without people coming by the house all the time to bring us food and vegetables from their gardens and such as that. People were real good to us up on Scrabble Creek. It was Daddy's voice that started it all, and even now, years and years later, I can close my eyes and hear him so plain, talking over that microphone hooked to the top of Carlton Duty's truck as they drove around the county. "Folks, we're having a big meeting on Saturday night over here by the river, about a quarter mile down from Carlton Duty's store. You know where that is, folks. You all come on out. You'll see the other cars there. You'll see Jesus himself there, for it's him that's calling this meeting over here on Saturday night. It's Jesus, my beloved. He hopes to see you there." Daddy's voice was soft and pleading. It made you want to do whatever he said. Then he'd add, "And if anybody finds a big rattlesnake, why, bring him along, and we'll take him up in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, beloved. In Jesus' name. Come on out in Jesus' name." This is what Daddy would call his church when they built it, the Jesus Name Church of God, for he loved to say Jesus' name, as he told everyone. In fact, Daddy always baptized in the name of Jesus, and not in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, for those were not names, he said. Daddy had thought long and hard about the Bible and drew his own conclusions. He was dead set on what he believed, and neither the threat of jail nor the fear of death could sway him. I'm not running a scared race, he often said. A man ain't alive if he's scared to die. Everybody admired this. We were too little to go to that first meeting, but we were to hear about it for years afterward, as what happened there passed into legend. We heard it first from Mama. She used to tell it to Evelyn and Billie Jean and me on the days when she washed our hair. Some sinner boys from up on Holt Branch, the Graybeals, learned about the meeting and determined to break it up out of sheer meanness. So they laid off work and went around gathering up snakes until they had a huge yellow rattler and a smaller rattler and a big old lard can full of copperheads. They got in their truck and drove down off the mountain where they lived and arrived at the river after the meeting had been going on for some time. Cars were parked up and down the road. It was near about dark, so lanterns had been lit all around the brush arbor. Daddy had placed his own serpent box under the first bench the way he always did, in case God did not send him one, and had started off with prayer and singing. It was Daddy and a young man named Doyle Stacy on guitar, and Ruth Duty with her tambourine. Ruth had a high, trembly voice that would raise up the hair on your arms. The brush arbor was full, the benches packed, and people standing in the back. Some of these were believers from churches all around there, but most of them were doubters and sinners who had come along just to see what would happen. After the singing stopped, Mama stood up to read the scripture, as was usual. She would read while Daddy paced back and forth with his eyes closed and his head bowed, listening. Listening as intently as if he had never heard these words before and his life depended on it. This time Daddy called for her to read from the fourth chapter of the Acts of the Apostles, which she did, ending with verse 31. And when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and spoke the word of God with boldness. With boldness, Daddy shouted, making everybody jump. With boldness, my beloved. And as believers, can we do any less? God calls for us to be bold tonight, beloved, to turn our lives over to Him and open our hearts to His Holy Spirit, and He will fill us with rapture. Oh, my beloved, He will grant us powers which we have not dreamed of. I mean power, beloved. Oh, I know you're out there tonight saying, what do you mean, Brother Shepherd? Why, I have not got no power in this world. I have got laid off, and my wife is up sick in the bed, and my children are lost to Jesus, and it's hard times everywhere I look. It's a sea of trouble, Brother Shepherd, and you come in here talking about power. Why, you're just a joke. You just as best go back to wherever it was you come from, fast as you can go. But I say to you here tonight, oh, my beloved, it don't have to be this way. No, sorry. For God is the greatest source of power in this here universe, and all we have to do is open our hearts and minds up to Him this very evening and let Him work, and His power will run through us, and we can do anything. Anything, beloved. We can cure the sick. We can cast out devils. We can speak with new tongues, beloved. We can take up the deadly serpent in His name, and there is no harm in it, for Jesus has given us the power. Oh, He's coming down on us here tonight, beloved. I can feel it. I can feel Him right here. Can't you feel Him, brother? Can't you feel Him, sister? As he preached, Daddy paced back and forth with his white shirt and his white hair gleaming in the lamplight. Doyle Stacy and Ruth Duty were playing music over to the side while Daddy went on preaching, and before long, folks all over the brush arbor were leaping up to shout or pray or clap or start dancing. It finally built up to where the anointing came down on Daddy, as it always did, and he yelled, I can feel the power. Oh, I can feel the power right here tonight. Lord Jesus, oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Thank you, sweet Jesus.
Then Daddy reached under the bench and opened up the box and took a serpent out and draped it across his shoulders. All of a sudden, the air went electric, and some people were scrambling back, and others were surging forward, and the singing got louder and louder. This was the moment when the Greybeals chose to make their appearance. They came running in from the roadside of the brush arbor, all liquored up. One of them carried two sacks, and the others were holding the lard can between them.
"You want a serpent, preacher man?" they were hollering. "Here's a serpent for you."
They made their way to the front of the brush arbor and dumped those snakes out everywhere. People were yelling and crying and climbing all over each other and running every which way. Mama said you could not believe a place could clear out so fast. She ran to the woods, but Daddy would not go with her. The Greybeals hooted with laughter. Daddy stood right in front of the wooden cross and raised his arms and prayed for power while the snakes slithered and struck at his feet. Then he bent over and started scooping them up and hollering, "Oh, he's a great God!" and "Hallelujah!" Daddy unbuttoned his shirt and stuffed it full of copperheads and laid the big rattler across his shoulders and wrapped the little one around his neck and reached down to gather up the rest of them in his arms. He walked down the middle of the empty brush arbor until he got beyond the last slab bench. He stopped there in the wild light of the flaming lanterns and looked into the darkness, past the circle of flickering light where many stood huddled in the trees, waiting to see what would happen. Daddy was fully anointed and covered in snakes, which writhed around his arms and his body and popped out of the open front of his shirt. "It was something to see," Mama would say softly, her eyes shining when she came to this part. By now, she was plaiting our hair. Daddy raised his arms and stretched them out to the darkness. "Come back here, beloved," Daddy said softly in that voice which would not take no for an answer. "Come back. Come back to Jesus." And they did, many of them, crying and sobbing and calling out to Jesus, pouring back into the brush arbor almost as fast as they had rushed out of it. Doyle Stacy grabbed his guitar, and Ruth Duty started in again on the tambourine, joined by one of the Dotsons on Daddy's guitar and by the Klein sisters, who loved to sing. And as Daddy walked slowly back up the middle aisle to the front of the brush arbor, the Lord came down hard on the whole crowd so that everybody started to dance and shout or fell down on their knees to pray. There were those present who will swear to this day that Daddy gave off light like the sun. Many were blessed that night to come forward and pluck the serpents off of Daddy and handle them too, and nobody was harmed in any way. And tongues of fire came down on several, including Carlton Duty, who flung back his head and shouted out in the unknown language of the Lord for upwards of an hour. The Holy Spirit was so strong that night that three of the copperheads died from it, Mama said, right there in the service. Rufus Greybeal, who had been converted on the spot, was holding one of them when it went limp as a dish rag in his hand. "I went in there as a sinner and a fool," Rufus Greybeal said later, "and come out as a true believer." Though Daddy cautioned him not to think the whole thing was a show put on by God for his own benefit, Rufus was later to fall into the pit of pride, as Daddy called it, anyway. But this was a great meeting in which the Spirit of the Lord rested upon the brush arbor for an hour or more, and it was not over until late in the night, when Daddy took a torch and led a large group of people down to the Little Dove River and baptized them one after another in Jesus' name. "And when the last one was baptized," Mama always said, "now that was Mrs. Goody Keene, don't you know that the moon broke out from behind the clouds and lit up that whole riverbank bright as day. We could see every rock and pebble on the shore and laughed at how Mrs. Keene had got so caught up in the spirit that she had took her pocketbook right down in the river with her. We all rejoiced," Mama said, "and thanked God for it, and the moon stayed out for the rest of the night. The road looked like a silver ribbon," Mama said, "as we were coming home." Mama timed the story of the first brush arbor meeting so that it always ended just when she got to the last rubber band. Many unbelievers were convinced that night, And from then on, the Brush Arbor meetings were full to overflowing, with cars parked all up and down the road. Mama and Daddy took us children over there sometimes, but often we stayed home with Evelyn. When they were gone overnight, off preaching someplace, Ruth Duty or one of the other ladies would come to stay with us. Sometimes Ruth brought a chicken to fry up, and one time we had a pork roast. Another time she made us a batch of sugar cookies, and we ate them while they were still warm and washed them down with sweet milk she'd brought from the store. The cookies had little sprinkles of sugar on the top of them that stuck to your lips while you ate. Ruth would patch our clothes, too, and clean the house, claiming it was the least she could do. She taught us how to sew on buttons and crochet. It was not that Mama couldn't do these things. It was just that she was so caught up in Daddy's ministry. For Mama was truly religious and believed that Daddy had saved her in Atlanta, Georgia, where she was a dancing girl, actually a young widow with three little children to support. Now this is Joe Allen, Evelyn, and Billie Jean, who was nothing but a baby when Daddy came to town with a tent crusade. Their own daddy had been shot in the back for good reason, Mama always said. This was a Mr. Bevel Reed, Mama's first husband. And since Mama had run off from her home on the farm at a tender age to join up with his traveling show, she had no one to turn to at his death. She found a woman to keep the children so she could work, but Billie Jean was sick all the time and Mama got real low. She was down real low when she met Daddy. She didn't care about anything, not what she did nor what happened to her. She was mad at the whole world. It was in a spirit of making fun that she went to his tent crusade for the first time, on the arm of a fancy gentleman, for it had been in all the newspapers. Daddy had been arrested, then released, and everybody was waiting to see whether he would obey the judge. Mama and her gentleman friend had been drinking. They went to the crusade like it was a freak show. But Daddy knocked her socks off, Mama said. Though he was arrested again that very night, or perhaps because of it, he made a big impression. As the police were hauling him off, they ran right into Mama, who was wearing high heels, a green suit, and a little green hat with a bird on it. Daddy stared down at her with his piercing blue eyes, then leaned over, quick as a wink, and kissed her on the mouth. "You're all right, honey," he said. The police jerked him back and pulled him away, and of course Mama's gentleman friend was furious. Mama laughed it off at the time, but the next day she went to visit Daddy in jail, where he stayed for 30 days, refusing to pay the fine. When they finally released him on the condition that he would leave town, Mama went too, taking her children along. She never looked back. I was born about a year later in Kissimmee, Florida. Up on Scrabble Creek, even our home life revolved around Daddy's ministry. He held meetings on Wednesday nights, Saturday nights, Sunday nights, and every other Sunday morning. Sometimes we'd scarcely get back on Sunday before we had to go over there again. Even when Daddy was at home, he talked to God all the time. You could hear him on the porch or even out in the toilet. Sometimes you could understand the words and sometimes not. We had to pray and pray at bedtime on our knees. We had to pray over our meals, even if we had scarcely a thing in the house to eat, even if we were praying over nothing but cornmeal mush. We'd pray till the food was cold. Daddy did all this, I understood, because Jesus required it of him, and Mama did it because she loved Daddy. Mama loved Jesus, too, but I think she loved Daddy even more. She went with him to meeting and read the Bible out for him to preach, but she did not take up serpents herself. Many believers did not. It was only a few, some people called them the saints, who were blessed to do so, with special power that came from God in the form of anointing. It was not given to everyone, and I was real glad it had not been given to Mama. So I cried and cried the first time she handled fire, one winter night up on Scrabble Creek. Carlton and Ruth Duty had come over, as they often did, and they were in the front room with Mama and Daddy, reading the Bible and talking about it and praying all together, while me and Billie Jean played jacks on the kitchen floor.
We could not play cards or have a radio, but we could play jacks and paper dolls. Billie Jean was thin, with pale brown hair that came down in pointy wisps all around her thin little mouse's face. She did not look a thing like Mama, which I did. Maybe she looked like Mr. Bevel Reed, but if so, we didn't know it, as we had never seen his likeness. Billie Jean counted all the way up to 5 without missing. Daddy came out for his guitar and rumpled our hair on his way back through the kitchen. Billie Jean missed. They started singing in the front room, "I'm on my way to heaven, I can see that other shore, and I won't be coming back anymore." It was a real catchy tune, which I loved. I threw out the jacks and got up to 6 and then missed. We could hear them singing and dancing in the other room. The glasses in the kitchen cabinet started to rattle. Without a word, Billie Jean and I looked at each other, and she gathered up the jacks and the ball and put them in her pocket, and we went in there. It was clear that things had reached a certain point already. Ruth Duty was dancing, with her fat white arms held out to the side and her stomach and her bosom bouncing up and down. Mama had her eyes closed and bright spots of color on her cheeks. She looked like she was wearing makeup. Daddy was dancing around with his guitar. Carlton Duty was shuffling away by the heat stove with his hand over his heart, singing off-key, which didn't matter because the women were so loud. From the door, Billie Jean and me joined in. "Lord, I won't be coming back any more. Lord, I won't be coming back any more." Then all of a sudden, Mama flung her head back and started jerking and crying out in a scary way. No words, just sharp animal noises. I tried to go forward to her, but then Daddy was there, barring my way. I watched across his arm as Mama rushed over to the heat stove, still shrieking, and opened it up and plunged her hands in there and grabbed up the red-hot coals. Smoke poured into the room. "Jesus! Jesus! Blessed Jesus!" Carlton Duty was yelling as Mama danced all around the room with the burning coals in her hands. Ruth Duty fell down on the floor, moaning and sobbing. "Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord," Daddy said over and over. "Pray, little children, pray," he said to us. Billie Jean and I got down on our knees and fell forward, but I was not really praying. I was banging my head on the floor and saying, "I hate Jesus. I hate Jesus," over and over in my mind, because he was burning my mother. I fainted dead away right there, and they all thought God had come over me, but he had not. It turned out that Mama was just fine. I had a bruise on my forehead for 2 weeks, while she had nary a blister. The next day, she told us how it had felt. "It was a good feeling, Gracie," she insisted, smoothing my hair away from my face. "A good feeling. It was a pleasure in the Lord. Oh, honey, I don't know how to explain it. It was just too good to explain. First, it was like chill bumps come over me, and then my arms and my hands went numb, and I could hear that cold wind blow, and I got kind of a cold feeling in my heart. I could feel my hands drawing to do something, and before I knowed what was going on, the Lord had led me over there to the heat stove." "Now you listen to me, Gracie," she said, for I had put my hands up to my ears. "It was a perfect pleasure in the Lord, you silly girl." But I could not understand, and though Mama was anointed to do this many times later, I never could bear to see it. In those years up on Scrabble Creek, Mama was like a child herself, never too busy to stop her work and play with us. She was always happy and singing. Church songs, mostly, but also other songs from her days in the traveling show. "Katie, Goodbye," "Bill Bailey, Won't You Please Come Home," "My Blue Heaven," and "A Bicycle Built for Two," my favorite. Joe Allen actually had a bicycle, which his boss at the sawmill had given him, and he used to ride it over to give Mama some money every payday. He was living in the bunkhouse at the sawmill. If he had not done this, we never would have had any cash money, since Daddy didn't even carry a wallet, trusting always in the Lord to provide. Mama kept the money hidden and used to slip us some if we went to town. I never thought about this one way or the other until the day I heard Joe Allen arguing with Mama about it. "Just keep some of it back, Mama,
he was saying earnestly as he stood by the porch holding the handlebars of his red bicycle. He won't know the difference anyway. Joe Allen had freckles all over his face and one piece of brown hair that kept falling down into his eyes, no matter how often he slicked it back. He could not have told a lie or been mean to anybody if his life depended on it.
You can't tell what might happen, Mama. You never know what you might need it for.
Why, we don't want for a thing, honey, Mama said, laughing, as she looked around at the bright day and her blooming roses and Troy Lee down in the dirt with a spoon.
I was stringing beans on the porch.
That's just what you think right now, Mama, Joe Allen said. You keep some of this back, you hear me? You put it away someplace where he won't know, so you'll have it, like an insurance policy. I'm not going to give it to you if you're just going to give it all to the kids or let it go to church folks.
Joe Allen stood up straight and talked as serious as a man.
Joe Allen, I'm ashamed of you. Mama had a little fit of temper. What would your daddy say?
Number one, he ain't my daddy, and number two, I don't care what he would say, Joe Allen announced. You can tell him if you want to. There's other ways of looking at things, Mama. You ought to hear what they say in town, some of them.
Joe Allen pushed the money into her hand and got back on his bike.
What do you mean?
Mama clutched the porch post real tight.
Never you mind what I mean, Mama, Joe Allen said. You put that money away like I told you. I've got to get on back now. I'll see you, Mama. I'll see you next week.
Joe Allen looked like he was fixing to cry. He kicked off and rode down the hill at a furious rate of speed and disappeared down the road to town. I watched him go and wished that I could go with him.
I'll be praying for you, Joe Allen, Mama called after him in a wavery voice that seemed to hang in the hot, still air like the butterflies over the flowers.
She looked at the money in her hand and then at me.
What are you looking at?
She said in a voice that was as close as she ever came to being hateful. Then she went inside, and I never knew if she saved any of that money or any of the money that Joe Allen gave her every week until he had the big fight with Daddy. I didn't think Mama was capable of keeping anything from Daddy, though, for he was the master in our house, and she was often like one of us kids. Daddy was really old, for one thing. Whenever I pictured God, especially the God of the Old Testament who parted the Red Sea and sent boils to people and burned up Sodom and Gomorrah and smote his enemies dead, I pictured Daddy with his white hair and his sharp, bright eyes and his deeply lined face. His hands and arms were black and blue from serpent bites. He had lost a whole finger, the little one on his left hand, and most of the fourth finger, too. I used to hold that hand when we went to town.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.